Well, good morning and welcome to the Watered Garden. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we rejoice and we are glad in it. Let all of God's people rejoice. I want to encourage you today, as we are about to go directly into praise and worship, to shake off those heavy bands and lift up holy hands. Let all of God's people praise the Lord. Let's get ready to give God praise. Let's give him the fruit of our lips. Let's give him the words of our mouths. Let's give him the song on our hearts. And let's give him the thoughts that are on our minds. Thoughts of gratitude, thoughts of appreciation, thoughts of fully acknowledging his goodness towards us. That's what we're going to do. We're going to collect ourselves, our thoughts, our feelings, our emotions. We're going to collect them. We're going to focus on blessing the Lord, speaking well of the Lord, thinking well of the Lord, singing as unto the Lord, amen, with hearts full of just worship and thankfulness and appreciation for all that he's done. And then we're going to tell him who he is. And that's what worship is all about. Let's take the time to do that. All right, without further ado, I'm going to turn you into the most capable hands of our worship leader, Minister Sean Urey. God bless you.
Good morning. Let's sing unto the Lord. I just want to praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Blessing and glory and honor, they all belong. the Lord today. I thank the Lord today for blessing me with life, health, and strength, and just for blessing me with Him, with His presence. I love the Lord today. Do you love the Lord today? He is my help. And if you need Him to be your help, just confess that today. He is my help. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We come to bless the Lord today, and we thank Him for being our help today. Hallelujah, hallelujah. From whence cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord, the Lord which made heaven and earth. He said He would not suffer thy foot to be moved. The Lord which keepeth thee, He will not slumber nor sleep. No, the Lord is thy keeper, the Lord is thy shade. Upon thy right hand, upon thy right hand. No, the sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. He shall preserve thy soul, even forevermore. Upon thy right hand. all of my help comes from the Lord. My help. All of my help comes from the Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. That is one of my favorite songs. I used to love to hear a wonderful singer and songwriter, Jackie Gouchee, sing that song. But I tell you, Minister Yuri, oh yeah, Jackie Gouchee, she did. She is the writer of that song. And Sean, you never cease to amaze me. It was blessed my socks off. I'm so glad. And you know, our pastor, before I go into the confession of favor, he always says, we're going to seek the help of the Lord. And I do believe that we need people to help us achieve things. But when you seek the help of the Lord, I believe that God strategically places the right people in your life, the right situations in your life. But first, we must go to Him all, not some, not a little bit, not most, but all of our help comes from the Lord. What a song in season. What a song in season. Well, every Sunday in the Water Garden Fellowship, we confess the favor of God in our lives. And I pray that you're confessing this every day over your life. But every Sunday, we confess it with power, purpose, and passion in unison. And immediately, we lead into, I'm looking for a miracle. As a daily walk, looking for some miracle in some parts of our lives. So let's confess the favor of God in our lives. In the name of Jesus, I am the righteousness of God. Therefore, I am entitled to covenant kindness and covenant favor. The favor of God is among the righteous. The favor of God surrounds the righteous. Therefore, it surrounds me everywhere I go, in everything I do, and I expect the favor of God to be in manifestation. Never again will I be without the favor of God. It rests richly upon me. It profusely abounds in me, and I am part of the generation that is experiencing it immeasurably, limitlessly, and surpassingly. Therefore, favor produces supernatural increase, promotion, restoration, honor, increased assets, greater victories, recognition, prominence, preferential treatment, petitions granted, policies and rules changed, and battles won in which I do not have to fight. Favor is on me and goes before me. Therefore, my life will never be the same. This is the year of God's favor in my life. And that is the favor of God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Looking for a miracle, I expect the impossible. I feel the intangible, I see the invisible. I'm looking for a miracle, I expect. it. Hey, hey, believe and receive it. God will perform it today. There is no limit.
Yes, he will. Amen. Well, that brings us to our thought of the week. I'm going to give you 7 keys to life. There are many keys to life, but I'm going to share 7 with you. First, love God. Love God. Then second, love one another. 3, never hate. 4, give generously. 5, live simply. 6, forgive quickly. And 7, be kind always. And the next voice you'll hear is that of our pastor, and psalmist, Dr. Desmond Pringle.
Amen and praise God. Thank you so much, honey, and Minister Yuri, for all that you do every Sunday here at the Watered Garden. I am excited, as I always am, about today's message, and we're going to get right into it. Our God is great. Our God is powerful. Our God is almighty. Our God is all-knowing. He's omniscient. He's omnipotent. And these are not just adjectives that I am putting out here today just as a time filler. These are infallible, immutable, indisputable truths. God is all of those things that I just said and more. And this is what we've got to keep ourselves mindful of as we are traversing through these days and times that we find ourselves in. And so I want to get directly into the word today, and I'm going to be coming from, as for my principal scripture, is Deuteronomy chapter number 1, and we'll start at verse number 6 through the first part of verse number 7. And it reads, again, Deuteronomy chapter number 1, verses 6 and 7a. The Lord God spake unto us in Horeb, saying, ye have dwelt long enough in this mount. Turn you and take your journey. I'm going to stop right there. Turn you and take your journey. And I want to speak to you just for a few moments this morning from the topic, pandemic pivot. Pandemic pivot. Now, this sermon, I'm coming to you today. I just want to talk with you. And I really want to talk us. When I say us, that includes me. I just want to talk us into a space of sobriety and sanity. And I want us to, I believe that this word is coming to us today, that God is reminding us, first of all, that the season that we are still in, because the pandemic is not over. I know that many things have somewhat normalized. But this word is coming to us today because so many people in so many instances are just very, very, very anxiously waiting and putting pressure on. I just want things to get back to normal. And that working definition of things getting back to normal simply means I want things to go back to the way that they were. And this is what we've got to understand. It's never going to be Egypt again. Like the children of Israel, who God was talking to in this first chapter of the book of Deuteronomy. He said, you've dwelt in this mountain long enough. You've been in this frame of mind. You've been in this state of being. You've been here long enough. And remember, the wilderness was designed. The wilderness was devised for the sole purpose of working Egypt out. the way that things were done in Egypt, to get the people, the children of Israel, off of their Egyptian dependency and personally connected to a God dependency. I'm so glad that Minister Yuri sung that song today, "All of My Help Come from the Lord." All of our help comes from the Lord. And many times, we the people of God, we get so attached, so affixed, and so attentive to the resource that we lose sight of the source. Now, I know I should not have said "the" in front of a word that begins with a consonant, but it gives the emphasis that I needed. We must remain conscious of the truth that God is the source, not the job, not the person, not the entity, not any other power is the source. And sometimes we, when the resource is serving us so well, I remember years ago, or over 20 years ago, as a matter of fact, that I was thinking forward about a particular situation that I was in. And it was a good situation, a very good situation. And I was making plans, making very substantial plans with regards to this particular contract. And I remember I had managed the first part of that contract so well. And I know I've shared this before. I managed the first part of that contract so well, and so much so that I was looking forward to the second phase of it. And I will never forget that I heard the Holy Spirit say to me very clearly, "Don't make a permanent fixture out of a temporary situation." I felt like Scooby-Doo. And I heard it so clearly on the inside of me. And at the time, there was no sign that things would have been differently in the next 20-week period. I had already mapped out, anyway, so without going into all of it, the bottom line is I literally had taken thought for tomorrow. I did. Scripture tells us not to, but guilty as charged. But Holy Spirit said to me, "Don't make a permanent fixture out of a temporary situation." Now, what I love about that and the relevance of that, in this first chapter and the seventh verse of Deuteronomy, take your journey. In the New Living Translation, it reads as thus: break camp. What is a camp? A camp is a temporary place of accommodation. Whether it's a hut, whether it's a tent, it's temporary. It's not a permanent dwelling place. And just like you would not make a permanent dwelling place of a hut or a tent, there are seasons in our lives, and there are aspects of those seasons that God does not intend for us to make a permanent a dwelling place. And so it is. God has allowed, even if he did not send it, and I won't get into that debate because honestly, I don't have the answer. I don't know whether God sent the pandemic or not, but one thing is of a certainty, he certainly allowed it because it is here. It is here. I didn't say it was here. It is here. Just because the news is not talking about it, I told you, listen, listen, they are never going, as much as possible, they do not want to shut the economy down, okay? But there are still hospitals that are exhausted. Now, maybe not to the extent that they were back in the spring of 2020 when they had to bring makeshift morgues by way of 18-wheeler refrigerated trucks. And that was really, really, really bad. Really, really bad. May not be to that extent, but we're not out of the woods yet. And so many of us, we are drinking the Kool-Aid. We are drinking the proverbial Kool-Aid. And so much so, and let me say this, it's the proverbial Kool-Aid, not even of the world, but of the devil, of the enemy who do not want us to be discerning of the time and the season that we're in. And this is not about bad news. It's actually good news. Listen, like the sons of Issachar, they were men of understanding of the times to know what Israel ought to do. And this word of God is coming to us today for us to be sound, sober, and sane. Okay, listen, about the times that we are in, what is God saying to us? And so the power of the pivot, to turn. To pivot is to turn. What should we be centering around? This is the question to ask. That if you are discerning, and if you are, amen, conscientious, and if you are paying attention to what Holy Spirit is saying to you, and Holy Spirit is talking to you, he's not only interested in having a conversation with your favorite prophet. The Holy Spirit wants to have a conversation with you, about your life, about the days of your life. It is his job. It is his job. It is his job to lead you, not just make suggestions, not just make recommendations, but to lead you and guide you into all truth. Because the same Holy Ghost that is leading you and guiding you into all truth, according to Romans chapter number 8, this is the same Holy Spirit who is making intercession for you according to the will of God. So the Holy Ghost knows what he's talking about. He's not doing research. He's not taking stabs and jabs at what possibly may be or what may work or what might happen. He is totally in tune with your entire life, with my entire life. And so, for those of us, I believe the Holy Spirit is coming to us today. The power of the pivot, the power of the pivot, that the power of the pivot, the power of turning, the power of shifting, the power of making the switch. So I want to talk with us today. I want to encourage you today. And listen, as I am encouraging you, I am encouraging myself. When I got up this morning, listen, there were some shifts that had already taken place that I knew in my spirit. I did some different things, and I'll talk about it at another time. I won't get into it today, but I want to begin by saying, as one of the well-known hymns of the church articulates, time is filled with swift transition. Somebody say transition. Transition. Change is among us. Change is upon us. Change is in our midst. Whether you want to change or not, change is here. And it behooves each and every one of us to change with the ebbs and the flows of God. Not caught up in the current of the world, but as we are seeing change manifest and materialize in the world, listen, it is the world that we live in. Now, we are in the world, but not of the world. But let's be clear, we're in the world nonetheless. We're in the world. We're not in eternity. We're not in heaven. We're not like Anita Baker caught up in the rapture. No, 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 ma'am, and no, sir. We're in the world. And listen, you're in the world for a reason. You're in the world for a purpose. Of all of the people, I'm talking about just saints, the people of God. COVID came in and wiped out much of the church, believers, people who loved God. So you're not here accidentally. You're not here coincidentally. You're not here hypothetically. You are here intentionally by the plan and by the hand of God. We are still on the planet. And so as we are on the planet in the midst of all of the hysteria that is going on, amid all of the change that is going on, we've got to embrace transition. Father God, what are the changes? What are the changes that I am needing to make so that I could be in lockstep with not just what's acceptable, not just what's good, but what is perfect. The Bible says that ye may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect. Perfect. See, some of us, we're hanging out in the realm of the acceptable. In other words, it's no shame attached to it. It's all right. It's not bad. Some of us are hanging out in the realm of the good. You know, it's good. It's all good. You know, it's no complaints, no regrets. It's good. But I believe that God is wanting us in the context of transition, in the context of the shift. God wants us to experience the perfect, that ye may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. When it's perfect, it doesn't get any better than this. That's what perfection is all about. Perfection is the zenith. Hallelujah. He said, and be not conformed, in Romans chapter number 12, verse number 2, and be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of the mind. This is what this transition is all about. We need a mental transition. We need a paradigm shift. When we talk about this, the power of the pivot, we're talking about a shift, a transition in the way that we think, in the way that we see, and the way that our thinking is going to change is by being renewed in the Word of God, is by spending time in the Word of God. And let me tell you why it is so critical that we spend time in the Word of God, in the presence of God, so that our minds are being renewed, because when we do that, Holy Spirit knows how to point us in the right direction with the right connections. Glory to God, so that we are having prophetic perception about things that specifically concern us, so that we are not just hanging out in acceptable, we're not just hanging out in good, but we are experiencing perfection. Perfect, the perfect will of God. All right, that's transition to change, and time is filled with it. All right, I got to keep moving. So God wants us to experience transition so that we then could experience, here's the next thing, transcendence. I don't know about you, but in this season of my life, I am becoming more and more uncomfortable and dissatisfied with the mediocre. With the mediocre in many aspects of life. And I won't take the time to list things that I'm specifically affected by or things that I'm focusing on, because I don't want to minimize the perspective and put this in a small context, because none of us have the same fingerprints. None of us have the same DNA. None of us are having the same life experience. So the limits, and that's what transcendence is all about. It's going beyond the limits of the known, of the common, or the familiar. And that is what this pandemic pivot is giving us the opportunity to do. Now, I will tell you, you know, this is not just hey, bay, shay, and hook a messiah. That's my way of talking about speaking in tongues or spiritual things. Many times in the church, we only focus on the spiritual. But you're not just a spirit. You are a spirit that possesses a soul that lives in a body. So your spiritual well-being is only one third of your being. So if we are, I've said this all the time, if we are ignoring, if we are neglecting, if we are not paying attention to our souls and our bodies, we are neglecting of the greater majority of our being. And it's not okay. It's not okay, because God has given us spirit. We're spirit, right? But he's given us a body and a soul so that we can experience dominion in the earth. And so dominion, God wants us to transcend. That is to move beyond the limits of just mere survival, of just mere existence, in every aspect of it, in our marriages, in our family life, in our health, in our finances, in our relationships, in our mental well-being, every aspect of life that you can experience, it is the will of God that we would be a people, because we're his people, that we would be experiencing increase, abundance, and overflow in every area. And so, people of God, since God is Jehovah Jireh, the God that provides, if he's the El Shaddai God, the God of abundant supply, if he is the God that is more than enough, if he is the God that does the exceeding abundantly above all that we may ask or think, then why is it acceptable to any of us to live in deficits? Why is deficiency normalized? Why is it that we're okay with it in any area? So listen, so I want to encourage you today, even as I'm encouraging myself. Listen, take inventory. What are the limits beyond which I should be? Hallelujah. That I need to transcend. So transcendence is of the order of the day. And this is something that we will be delivered to us as we conscientiously get into the power of the pivot. God, there's some changes that I have to make. There are some adjustments that I have to make. And I'm telling you, people of God, in life, changes and adjustments are necessary. You don't believe it? You think about that. Listen, even in, let me use a carnal example. You know, I remember as I was preparing this message today, I was reminded of a place in Los Angeles and it wasn't that long ago. When First Lady and I, we were like, okay, let's do a movie tonight. We just, you know, and we love, because we're gone a lot, you know, having the opportunity to just be at home. It's like, wow, what a concept. We are home and don't have anything pulling on us. Okay. So I remember it was nothing for us to, you know, go to the Blockbuster, you know, there and, you know, in Hollywood, or right on the outskirts of Beverly Hills, actually, right down from the Beverly Center. That was the spot, because it was the big, you know, big Blockbuster, and any movie, even the movies that some of the other Blockbusters didn't have, they would have. Okay, but I remember one time going in there, and it started being rumored that they were going out of business. What? Blockbuster's going out of business? That doesn't make sense. Because all over town, we started seeing these red box kiosks. Now, it was a new kid on the block. Here it is. Blockbuster was the established brand. So when we started seeing these kiosks, who wanted to do that? You know, that was the first initial response. But guess what? And so the rumor was that Blockbuster was going to cease to exist. Well, fast forward to 2022. Today, guess what? Blockbuster ceased to exist. And why am I saying this? I took the time to make that point, that you and I have got to be committed to transcendence, that we are committed to living and moving and thinking and operating and functioning beyond the limits of what we know, of what is common to us and what is familiar to us. And the way that we're going to empower ourselves to do this is by embracing the power of a pivot, of making a turn. I'm making the turn. I'm making the change. I'm making the shift, not necessarily because I want to, but because I have to. If you did not make the shift, and your only way of getting a movie was going to Blockbuster, guess what? You are not watching movies anymore at all. If you have not made the shift to streaming, you are not watching movies at home. Not that watching movies, I'm just using that literally. I'm using it metaphorically, but I'm using it actually because I want to drive home a point. If you are resistant to change, you are going to miss the move of God. So transition, change is already here. Transcendence, I've got to be personally committed to moving beyond the limits. And then my last point today is transaction. What is a transaction? A transaction is an exchange. It's an exchange. It is an interaction between different parties. I'm giving something, you're receiving something. You're receiving something, I'm giving something. So for instance, when I just bought these glasses, I gave these people, glory to God, I gave them my credit card, they gave me the frames. When I went to the optometrist to get my prescription, I gave him some money and he gave me my prescription lenses. I had a need, he had a need. He had a product, I was in need of the product. He had a service, I needed my eyes because listen, my glasses had broken and I was walking around because everything is, all of my other frames were in Los Angeles. So the only pair that I had broken and I went for a few days without glasses to the extent that I don't wear glasses because it's a fashion statement. I've been in glasses since second grade. I need them. They are a necessity. And so I had a transaction with these different service providers and these different retailers. That's what I'm looking for. Hey, I'm doing so much real estate stuff that I almost said realtors. I didn't mean that. Okay. But with the retailers, glory to God. So it was a transaction. People, you've got to be transactional. And what is God saying to us in the area of this transaction? In the instance of the power of the pivot. Why is God saying, I want you to turn? Just like he was trying to give the children of Israel a new experience. He was not just taking them through changes just for the heck of taking them through changes. He wasn't taking them through a trial and a tribulation just to be taking them through a trial and a tribulation. He was trying to engage in a transaction. I'm trying to get Egypt completely and totally out of you so that you can become totally dependent upon me. And I'm going to prove to you in the process of this transaction that I can be counted on. I can be relied on. I can be dependent on. I'm going to give you in the middle of the desert. If you get thirsty, I don't need a sea. I don't need a river. I don't need a brook. I'm going to show you that out of a dry place, a rock, it doesn't get any drier than a rock. Out of a hard place, it doesn't get much harder than a rock. He said, I'm going to quench your thirst by causing water to come out of a rock. You're going to see it. I'm going to feed you. You don't have to go down to the Egyptian cafeteria anymore. He said, but in the middle of the desert, I'm going to furnish a table. And the Bible indicates that they had two buffet meals every day. All you can eat. It wasn't just portion. You know, sometimes when you used to go back in the day before the pandemic, when we would have, amen, church gatherings, there's nothing like stingy church food. They give you a teaspoon of potato salad, a teaspoon of the starch, a teaspoon of the vegetable, and then one little piece of meat, and they tell you what? All right, go on through the line and come on back after everyone has been served. That's not what God did, my brother and sister. In the Bible, read it for yourself. It's in the book. I didn't write it, and I'm not making it up. They could eat all that they wanted to eat in the desert. No kitchen. No caterer. It was God that furnished the table. Why? He said, and let me read it. Let me read it. Let me read it verbatim. Hallelujah. Let's look at, hallelujah. And I'm almost through. Somebody say the power of the pivot. The power of the pivot. I'm giving you these stories today. I'm giving you these examples today because some of us have some changes to make. Some of us have some turns to make. Some of us have some shifts to make. And listen, I'm pointing at you, but I'm not focusing on this finger that I'm showing to you. I'm focused on these three that's pointing back at me. Because let me tell you something. I am zeroing in on the shifts that need to happen in my life. I'm zeroing in on the changes that need to be made. And I'm zeroing in, hankering down, hunkering in, closing in on the power of the pivot. And so in Deuteronomy, and I'm almost through, in Deuteronomy chapter number 8, the pivot. the power of the pivot. Judy, I declare and decree that there is a power in the pivot in your business. Oh, glory to God. I want it for you. I'm believing it for you. Oh, yes, I am. I told Tanya just the other day. I ain't even going to tell you what I said to her. But what I want you to know is that your pastor is believing God for the power of a pivot, a power in your production, a power in your productivity, a power in your personal experience. Listen, and I'm believing that God is blessing all of the works of your hand. We are declaring increase, abundance, and overflow. You have been diligent. You have been deliberate. You have been determined. And God said that he will not allow you to sow and not reap. Oh, glory to God. And when we talk about sowing, we're not only talking about giving financial seed into ministry. It includes that, but it's not exclusive to that. I want everyone under the sound of my voice, if you have a business, if you have an endeavor, if you have a passion that you have been working towards, but it looks like, feels like, seems like you're not getting the return that you're needing, I want you to put prayer, pressure on what you're needing to see, and you have scripture to back you up. The Bible says that whatsoever, that is a blank line. It is not exclusive to any one specific aspect of life. The Bible says that whatsoever a man, we're talking about the species, not the gender. So it's not just male, whatever a man, a woman, a boy, a girl sows, that shall he or she also reap. And to make sure that the point was clear, look at what God further says. He says, because if you sow to the flesh, you're going to reap of the flesh. It works both ways. It works good and bad. So how much more? Let me tell you something. Keep sowing in your business. Keep sowing into your education. Keep sowing into your passion. And when I say sowing, I'm talking about financially. I'm talking about emotionally. I'm talking about with your efforts, with your energy, with your initiative. Keep sowing, because you cannot not reap when you sow. Let me finish the scripture. Whatsoever a man, woman, boy, girl, soweth, that shall he or she also reap. Reaping is a guarantee. Though the vision tarries, though it has not manifested yet, I need you to understand that yet is the operative word. We have a God that we can depend on. We have a God that we can believe in. We serve the God who is not a man that he should lie, and he doesn't repent. In other words, God is not going to say something, his word returns to him void, and then he says, oh, that's not what I meant. That's repenting on what he said. That's repenting on what he meant. Oh, you know what? I probably shouldn't have said that. Hey, there's no promise that God has given us that his attitude, his disposition, and his resolve will ever be, well, I know that's what I said, but that's not what I meant. What he said, he meant. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. And so today, in my conclusion, let me review and go to my final point. So transition. Time is filled with swift transition. And so I've got to transist. I've got to change. And I've got to go with the flow, not of the world, but with the flow of God. Transition. And then I'm transitioning. Why? So that I can experience transcendence. Transcendence, that I'm living life beyond the limits of the known, the common, and familiar. And then as I experience transcendence, hallelujah, I'm going to be a participant. Isn't this awesome? I get to participate in transactions with God. So I ask you to bring your attention to Deuteronomy chapter number 8, verse number 3. God said, and he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger and fed thee with manna, which thou knewest not, neither did thy fathers know, first of all, that he might make thee to know that man doth not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. Let me unpack that. In other words, he's saying that, look, God said that it was him. It was him that caused us to hunger, that caused the children of Israel, rather, to hunger so that they could know. He took you into the wilderness. He took you out of Egypt to prove a point. You don't need Egypt. Hey, come on, let me get Ebonic with it. You don't need Egypt. And Egypt is metaphoric and representative of every other power that tries to make you feel like you can't make it without them. Any person, any organization, any job, any man, any woman. I feel a Gloria Gaynor anointing. I will, no. And not only will you survive, you're gonna thrive, you're gonna flourish. Did you think I'm going to break down and die? That you think that I can't make it without you? Some of you may have been experiencing in this pandemic a substantial changes to your employment. Listen, you are the seed of the righteous. And the Bible says that I've never seen the righteous nor forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. You're not a bread beggar. Hallelujah. But you are a man and woman of God who experiences your Father, Abba, Father God, providing and supplying all of your needs. And this is what the transaction is all about. We're going from transition to transcendence to a transaction. Hallelujah. The transaction, we see it in Deuteronomy. But then the other transaction, God says, I'm going to give you beauty for ashes. Hey, he said, I'm going to give you the oil of joy. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Then he says, I'm going to give you the garment of praise. Hallelujah. Those are just a few transactions. And so, people of God, in my conclusion today, I encourage you to personally, in your own world, in your own space, to possess the power of the pivot. And what do I mean by that? Make the decision to make the change. Just today, right where you are, just decide that I am a candidate for change. In other words, I know what I'm used to. I know what I'm accustomed to. I understand how things have been. Oh, glory to God. But as we are navigating a new normal, I want to encourage you to get with the program and quit kicking against the pricks, as it were, trying to get back to the place of the familiar. Bibi and Cece sung a song in the 80s. One of the lines, I'm going to conclude on this, some hang on to what used to be, living their lives, looking behind. But today, as we are embracing transition, transcendence, and transactions, I want you to begin to ask God to lift you up, minister you. Ask God to lift you up. Lift you up where you belong. I want you to ask God to lift you up so that you can look up, so that you can look up to the hills. See, one of the reasons why some of us can't look to the hills is because we're too far down. We're too far down, and our vision has been obscured. Our vision has been blocked. We can't see beyond what is right within eye view. But let's ask God to lift us up so that we can look up to the hills from whence cometh our help, because all of our help comes from the Lord. And this, my friends, is the power of the pivot.
Which made heaven and earth.
said he will not suffer thy foot to be moved. The Lord which keepeth thee, he will not slumber nor sleep.
Praise God. Let's keep that clean. Hallelujah. We just want to improvise today. Hallelujah. The help of the Lord is your portion. Do you hear me? The help of the Lord is your portion. The help of the Lord is my portion. Wherever you are, just begin to worship the Lord and make this affirmation. The help of the Lord is my portion. It belongs to me. I have access to it. I can confess it. I can move it. Oh, glory to God. I can make good on it. I can apply it to my situation, to my circumstance. I am not living life alone. I am not living life on my own. I have the help of the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. I pray that today, that as you make that your declaration, your decree, I pray right now that you will begin to experience the help of the Lord like never before. This will not just be an affirmation, an affirmation, hallelujah, just a declaration and a decree. It will be your personal experience, your personal possession in the name of Jesus. Without, I'm going to ask you to prepare to join us for prayer. Go on the website, thewgf.com. That's our website. You'll be able to speak. You can go right now at the light time. Amen. You can see our prayer time during the week on Wednesday mornings. Amen. I want you to pray about sowing seed into the Word of God. And I want to tell, and all of that, the ways to give, all of that is online, thewgf.com. All right, we're about to leave this place. We're about to get off this virtual experience. But I want to encourage you to make a personal decision to engage in the necessary power of the pivot. All right, my time, thank you, Minister Yuri. My time is up. And I thank you for yours. May the Lord bless and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and give you his peace. Peace in your going out. Peace in your coming in. Peace in your uprising. Peace in your downsetting. And you know what? I let me do this too. For all of you who have given and who are giving, this is what we want to make this confession. We do this when we're physically gathering. We declare that we expect our seeds to go and grow and bring us a harvest. Go and grow and bring us a harvest. Go and grow and bring us a harvest in Jesus' name. Listen, the kingdom works, all the kingdom principles and values, protocols, procedures, and resources, they all work. Hallelujah. Because our God is almighty and all powerful. So we bless him. All right. Grace and peace. Blessings on your week. And we look forward to seeing you next week. And I know that we did communion last week, but you know what? Let's begin this next season of next week is the first Sunday of September. Glory to God. And we'll talk more about that then. Let's be prepared to partake of the Lord's Supper. God bless you is my prayer.